Night sweats, hot flashes, osteoporosis, insomnia, hair loss, anxiety, dry skin, fatigue, moodiness, irritability, reduced sex drive, vaginal dryness, painful intercourse, heart palpitations, slow metabolism, weight gain, headaches, depression, bladder control problems, memory problems, achy and stiff joints, and my personal favorite, belly fat. And those are just some of the symptoms of menopause. Hi ladies, it's Erin and welcome back to my channel. Grab your coffee, grab a comfy spot on the couch, brace yourself. We're gonna talk about menopause today. We're gonna get in there, we're gonna dive in, we're gonna dissect it. There's a lot I wanna share with you. There's a lot that you all shared with me that I'm gonna share with you. Hopefully we can collectively pool our resources and become advocates for our own healthcare and really help to manage our transition in this phase of life a little bit more elegantly and a little bit more joyfully. Recently, I expressed through my email newsletter that I send out once a week. And if you haven't subscribed to my newsletter, you may really enjoy that newsletter because I do kind of share a lot of personal thoughts in that weekly editorial letter. But anyway, I shared that I was very upset and just having a hard time with the weight gain because I had gained weight around my belly. Remember, I am a stylist, so I can hide it really well, and I'm also still a very small person. So when I gain 10 pounds, like nobody really flinches that much, but I do because I notice the excess belly fat. I notice how my jeans don't fit me anymore. I notice how clothes don't fall the same way they used to, how I don't feel as comfortable in fitted clothes, all of those things. And I know many of you are experiencing that as well. But when I expressed that in my email newsletter, the response was so amazing and incredible. Literally hundreds of you wrote back to me and shared what you are doing and what is working for you in your menopause journey. So my team and I assembled this information, and that's really what I wanna share with you in this video. I wanna talk a little bit more about my journey, and then I also wanna share the resources that you all shared with me. First, I just wanna define what menopause is, so you understand. So there's perimenopause and menopause. Perimenopause is that period leading up to menopause where you can still have symptoms, the ones that I read in the beginning, but you still also have your period. Oftentimes you have a very heavy period that happens, is very common. Menopause is when your doctor, your endocrinologist, your naturopath, your GYN tests your FSH, follicle stimulating hormone. If that is high and elevated, that can indicate whether your ovaries are functioning or not and whether or not you're in menopause. Now, it's not just your FSH. It also is that you haven't had a period in 12 months or more. Then you are fully in menopause. You've passed through that transition. I lost my period at 42. I did a video about that. If you missed it, I'll put it below. But I lost the period at 42, thought I was pregnant actually, didn't end up being pregnant, ended up being menopause. Tested the FSH really high, said this indicates you're already through menopause. Well, about 8 months later, I got a period back again, and then it lasted for like 6 months, I think, and then I lost it again, and I've been on that roller coaster ever since. Whee! Going without one, getting one, not having one again. So I am technically not fully in menopause because I have not been without a period for 12 months. Interestingly, the average age of a menopausal woman is 51. So I was 42, which is very young. But for most of you, that's going to look like your late 40s, early 50s. You probably have some perimenopausal symptoms, maybe starting like at the age I am now, 45. So with menopause, there are treatments you can try to help combat the symptoms. They are still controversial, and there are still a lot of questions around treatment. The most common treatment that you can try is hormone replacement therapy. So when you lose those hormones, you drop in testosterone, you drop in estrogen, you drop in progesterone. Those are the hormones that you can take to try and replenish and get back to feeling more like you. And that is definitely the most common form of treatment. And within the HRT family, there are two types. There's bioidentical and synthetic. The common belief is that bioidentical is better, but according to the FDA, there is no better or worse when it comes to the cancer-causing potential. So there is a very slim risk of getting certain types of cancer when you are on hormone replacement therapy, that risk is not diminished if you take bioidentical versus synthetic. It's the same according to studies. Personally, I do a mix of both, and I have a bioidentical progesterone prescription and I have a synthetic estrogen prescription. And this is something that's very personal and it has to be a case by case, and you have to talk to your doctor about it, because if you have cancer in your family, like breast cancer in your family already, this might not be a great option for you. If you've already had cancer, this is not going to be a great option for you. Look at all of these symptoms and then the risks associated with taking the HRT, and then make your very informed decision, strategic decision. One of the things I mentioned in the beginning is belly fat. That's definitely been one of the bigger struggles for me, just this redistribution of weight, kind of accumulating fat around my belly where it's never been like that before, and all of the usual things that I try to get rid of it aren't working. And so that's very off-putting for me. A lot of my business is clothing and wardrobe, and can't fit into half my clothes. So the reason that's happening is because the loss of estrogen can mean that you're not as effectively using the starches and the sugars. And so it's increasing fat storage, making it harder to lose weight. You also can lose more easily muscle mass. Muscle is what speeds up the metabolism. Your metabolic rate may lower, which means the amount of calories you burn doing nothing each day is lower. Those are just some of the things that happen as a result of losing the estrogen, and why it's very common for menopausal or perimenopausal women to gain weight. Let's talk about what you can do about the symptoms, right? So we talked a little bit about HRT, or hormone replacement therapy. Personally, I take a progesterone pill every day. I have an estrogen patch that I apply right around my abdomen once a week. I do not take testosterone. I tried that with the drops under my tongue and I didn't like the way that it made me feel. I felt like kind of agitated and angry, and so that just didn't feel like it was right for me. The other thing that tends to happen pretty commonly are thyroid issues when you're in perimenopause and menopause, and that's something you should definitely check as well. If you go for a regular physical like I did, they're like, oh, your thyroid's fine, you know. And then once I started diving into the process a bit more and started seeing more specialists, I realized that actually isn't true. It's not that your GP is making a mistake, they just don't test as extensively as somebody else would. So I strongly suggest and advise that you go see somebody who specializes in this area that can really help you. And if you don't want to do HRT, there are also, you know, natural ways that you can try to replace some of the hormones that you're losing. And so that's something you can consider too. There are so many tips when it comes to what you eat in this period of time that can be helpful. You'll know pretty quickly what triggers your hot flashes if you get them. I know for me that if I have caffeine in the afternoon, and also MCT oil, which is a random thing to have, but MCT oil is supposed to work like an appetite suppressant and also give you natural energy. So it, in theory, it's awesome. But for me, it triggers hot flashes pretty much every time. So you'll figure out what triggers your hot flashes or what triggers your symptoms pretty quickly. Eating a diet that's whole foods, not processed, is definitely going to be better. One quick resource I wanted to mention, a friend of mine, her name's Carrie Roberts, developed an app called SIFT, S-I-F-T, and her app will allow you to scan a barcode of a food item, and you can tell within seconds, you know, what it has in it and whether it's processed or not. Go into your pantry and do it. You could do it in the grocery store. I think that would be a really helpful resource. Of course, drinking lots of water helps. Avoiding soda and alcohol. Alcohol could be a hard one for a lot of you. I don't drink, so that one's not an issue for me. And then obviously exercise is a big part of it too. So I wanted to share what a lot of you recommended that was working for you in terms of diet. So many of you are doing Weight Watchers. That one really surprised me. Like, I knew Weight Watchers was popular and Oprah does it and all that, but I didn't realize how popular it was and how many of you are doing Weight Watchers. Another one is intermittent fasting. And that's where you don't eat for a specific amount of time each day. So I actually have been doing intermittent fasting since like April. I don't eat before noon, and then I don't eat after 8 p.m. So I eat in this window of 12 p.m. to 8 p.m. and that's it. I've lost maybe 2 pounds since I started intermittent fasting, so I don't think it's this huge game changer in terms of weight loss, but you can try it, right? It doesn't hurt to try different things. For me, intermittent fasting feels like kind of how I've always eaten anyway. It feels like the most accessible to me. Another diet that many of you talked about is keto. I did do a video about my keto experience, and I did keto before I did intermittent fasting, and keto definitely works, but you have to stay on it. Like, it has to be a lifestyle, and I just couldn't imagine that being my lifestyle. The other one is a plant-based diet, and that's obviously no meat, and a couple of you mentioned The Plant Paradox by Dr. Stephen Gundry, G-U-N-D-R-Y, as a resource for plant-based diet and information about a plant-based diet. Okay, so with exercise, I wanted to share some of the things that are working for you all, and then I'll talk about what I've been trying and doing. Weight training was a big one. Pilates was number 2, high-intensity interval training number 3, yoga number 4, and walking number 5. Those were the 5 types of exercise that you all were doing and finding were the most effective. Last year, I ran and ran and ran and ran. You may remember I ran the New York City Marathon last year. I ran a mountain pass run that was 17 miles before that. Like, I'm not gonna gain weight. I'm gonna keep running. Which was not sustainable for me. It's not. It's just that kind of that level of cardio and exercise was not sustainable. Plus, my body didn't feel good. My feet were all mangled. I had like missing toenails and blisters and calluses and joints were hurting. It just wasn't something that made my body feel really good. So after that, I started an exercise called P-Volve. And that's really lovely, feels good with my body. I feel like it's really effective, but there's no cardio at all. So if you do something like that, you have to add in cardio. Skiing, walking the dog, anywhere I can get my cardio in, I am. I still haven't found what I feel like is like the tried and true formula, but I think at this point what's best for me is just to mix things up because I feel like I get bored so easily and I don't want to lock myself into one workout program and then find that I'm bored with it. And now I just want to talk about some of the vitamins and supplements that you all are taking. I have a list. B12, primrose oil for hot flashes, biotin for the hair dryness and thickness, collagen powder for thickness of hair, vitamin D for energy, adrenal supplement, DIM. DIM is something that flushes out extra estrogen. And then DHEA was another supplement that some of you talked about, and that is an alternative to testosterone. Some other things you talked about that were helpful, acupuncture. Some of you are doing acupuncture to help stave off those symptoms. Cool sculpting as a way to combat the belly fat, which I love that one. Apple cider vinegar is another one that people are buzzing about on the internet in terms of combating belly fat. I did try for a short time drinking apple cider vinegar and water, mixing it with some lemon and stevia drops, which was fine and I got used to the taste, but it's not realistic for me to do that every day. Some days I'm out and about, sometimes I'm traveling, and you're not gonna bring like a big bottle of apple cider vinegar with you everywhere you go. So I actually found a gummy company, I'll put a link to it below, where they create gummies with apple cider vinegar. So that's what I'm trying now. I can't tell you if it's working or not. I'm just trying it. Menopause Taylor on YouTube focuses her whole channel on menopause. She also teamed up with a friend of mine, Angie Hot and Flashy, and they did a video kind of answering a lot of different questions about menopause, which I thought was really good, really helpful. So I'll put a link to that video below too for you guys to check out. Another book, The Hormone Cure by Dr. Sarah Gottfried, was a resource that is recommended by one of the doctors here in town. I've downloaded it on Audible, but I haven't actually listened to it yet. And one of you mentioned a website called Happy Hormones, Natural Hormone Alternatives. That would be a good resource to check if you are interested in going more of the natural route. There is one other thing and one other category I want to talk about, and this is really uncomfortable for me to talk about, but I do think it's important to share because this is one of those symptoms that not many of us talk about, but I'm gonna discuss it today. I'm taking one for the team. One of the things I was experiencing, one of the many symptoms I was experiencing, vaginal dryness, painful intercourse, and a thinning of the vaginal tissue, which is what causes the painful intercourse, as well as bladder problems. right? So I've kind of had some issues with incontinence since I had kids. You know, that's where like you're doing jumping jacks and all of a sudden you pee a little bit in your pants, or where like you have to go to the bathroom and then there used to be this time frame where you could get to the bathroom and you'd be fine, and then all of a sudden it's like you have to go really bad and then like you're almost peeing your pants on the way to the bathroom. I don't know what the hell that is, but that's something that occurs for me after babies and menopause. On top of all that other stuff, we also get to feel like we're not really a woman. It's just horrible, right? It's horrible. It's absolutely horrible. Painful intercourse is horrible. And if you're experiencing it, I am so freaking sorry, because it is really awful. And then you don't feel like, you know, you can perform your wifely duties in the way that you're used to, and you don't enjoy it as much. And there's just all these things that come along with that. That's so bad. I'm gonna share what's out there and then what I did that's been helpful to me. The first thing you can do is talk to your doctor about getting an estrogen supplement. It's like a capsule that you can put inside the vagina. It's not systemic, it's local. So it's just delivering estrogen directly to that area, and that can help with the vaginal dryness and the painful intercourse. There's something called vaginal Valium. I didn't know about it. My doctor said, talked about it, which is supposed to help relax the vagina. If you notice I changed clothes, it's because I did. It's a different day. I actually taped this 2 weeks ago, and it turns out it never recorded. So in a weird twist of fate, here I am talking about the vagina again a second time. And that should really speak to how dedicated I am to this and how important I think this topic is, because quite frankly, I did not want to be sitting here again talking about the vagina again. And yet here we are. So I didn't actually use the vaginal Valium, but my understanding is that it relaxes the walls. So if you're used to painful intercourse, your reaction is generally going to be tense. You're going to clench up, tense up. And so that is meant to relax the walls of the vagina. The third thing you can do is some sort of laser treatment. There's two different types of technology. There's the CO2 laser and then the radio frequency laser. So the CO2 laser makes tiny little cuts, which then heal up to produce more collagen and build up the tissue. The radio frequency laser actually uses heat energy to do the same thing. In my experience, because I had the radio frequency Thermiva treatment done, your walls are thicker. You don't have as much of an issue with the incontinence. It's not as much of an issue being dry, and it's not painful. So for me, it was a game changer, and I think it was worth it. And I think you should talk to your doctor about it before deciding to do it. I think it's amazing. So basically you go through three treatments, and the three treatments are supposed to last around a year. It's a little bit on the pricey side, but I think in terms of treatments, this is worth saving for. When I finished getting my treatments and I was talking to my husband about it, and I said, you know, I just didn't feel like I was a woman anymore because I wasn't able to perform in that way. And so I hadn't even realized how much of an impact it had on my emotional well-being and my sexual health and also my marriage, and it did. This is something I've wanted to share with you guys for a while. I had the treatments done and finished my third treatment about 3 months ago, and it's just made a huge difference. That's it, that's everything I have so far. That's all of the resources that I've gathered from all of you, all of the resources I've gathered from the numerous, innumerable doctor's visits I've had and blood samples I've done and treatments I've tried. I've said before, it's like being on a roller coaster, except you don't know when the ride's gonna stop. You're just trying to find a formula that works for you. Some people think like, just let it be, you know, just let it take its course and run its course. And that might be a more sane way to go. I don't know. It depends on how bad your symptoms are, and it depends on how much it affects you emotionally, mentally, physically. For me, I'm a fighter. I want to solve the problem. I'm going to keep going. I'm going to stay the course until I can find a solution that really works well for me. I think I'm on the right path right now with my estrogen, progesterone, the Thermiva treatment I did, and maybe annually renewing that. Also the collagen, I think that's a big help. And then I'm trying, you know, the apple cider gummies. I don't know if they're working or not. And I've made a pledge to myself to exercise every single day for 60 days to see if that has any notable impact on the weight gain that I've experienced. I'm hoping that it will. I'll keep you posted on that. But what I would really love to hear is what is working for you. We can learn from each other. We can share from each other. We can lift the cloud of mystery from menopause and, you know, answer each other's questions and just share resources. And I think it can make a huge impact and huge difference on this topic that we all go through, by the way, but none of us want to talk about, especially the vagina stuff. And I'm really sorry that I said the word vagina so many times, but it had to be done. And I had to share that because it is so important. And I hope that even if it impacts one of you, it is so worth me sitting here feeling so incredibly uncomfortable and uploading information about my sex life. But I think it's worth it. I do. So hopefully that'll help some of you. If you want to continue the conversation in the comments, you want to continue the conversation over on Instagram, I'm at BusbyStyle there. Thank you so much for watching this really important video to me, to you, and thank you also for sharing. Let's share, share resources, share what's working. I'll see you next time, and I'll definitely be back with a style video. Bye, you guys.